Yes, this isn't going to be as long as an introduction as Gabe probably deserves, but I know that you've come to hear Gabe, not me. I'm Bill Reynolds. I'm a retired Hope faculty member. Gabe is a member of the Hope College Music Department. He's on leave for this year, this academic year, at Gordon College in Massachusetts, where he's teaching and he's directing both the band and the orchestra. He wanted me to tell everybody that he will be back in Holland in the spring for a couple of Holland Symphony Orchestra concerts, so you don't have to boycott the symphony out of fear that he won't be there. Gabe told me yesterday that he's looking forward to this class, and I want him to know, and I want everyone to know, that I'm glad he's looking forward to it, because I am too. And I'm sure everybody who has taken a class from him before is in the same situation. So I'm going to be quiet and turn it over to Gabe and let him inform us. Thanks, Gabe.
Thank you, Bill. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all virtually, and I appreciate the ability to kind of teach from afar. I did certainly want to be able to teach HASP. I've enjoyed doing it in the past, and it is nice to be able to do it, even though I'm out in Massachusetts. It's kind of interesting. I'm actually from Massachusetts originally, so in some ways, this is me coming home for a little bit, but hopefully I'll be back in Michigan next year. We'll see how that goes. So we're going to talk about the flute for the next three classes, and I thought I would divvy up presentation for three different days. Today we're going to talk about the history, a little bit about what the flute itself is, and the evolution of the flute, and then the next two classes we'll talk about some of the important repertoire, and you'll get to hear a number of pieces that have been crucial to kind of developing the flute through time. But I thought, of course, since we're going to talk about the flute, I thought I would start with a little music. It's always good to start a music class with music. And this, the piece I'm going to play a part for you is a piece called Rituals by Blas Puchihar. And this is a piece that I've performed a couple times. And this, I believe, is from a recital I did at Hope 3 years ago. So I'll play a little bit of this so you can kind of get in the flutey mood, as it were. There's a little bit of silence at the beginning. Thank you. Oh, nice little peaceful way to kind of start the presentation. So I thought today we'd start just with a little bit of information about the flute. Some of you probably know this already, but I thought it would be a good place to kind of start anyways. The flute is the highest member of the woodwind family. And, you know, in the orchestra, that would be the flutes, oboes, clarinets, and bassoons. The saxophones are also part of the woodwind family, but they tend not to play in orchestra all that much. But they are prominent members of bands and, of course, in a jazz band. But the flute is sort of the highest. And a lot of times, you were in orchestra, bands, solo instruments, sometimes in jazz. Although I find that a lot of times in jazz bands, the flute is typically played by a saxophone player that doubles. There isn't a lot of room in jazz bands for just a solo flute player. I played in high school for a little while. I can't say I was particularly good at it. But in all of these ensembles, the flute is primarily a melodic instrument. So a lot of times if there's something that needs to be prominent melodically, the flute will get it. Sometimes the oboe will get it. Every once in a while, we'll do something that's kind of rhythmic or harmonic, but most of the time we're playing the melody and what's going on. It is one of the oldest instruments known, and we'll kind of get into that a little bit. That's sort of the first topic that we'll kind of dive into. But how does the flute work? Well, so there are three parts, and I'll show them in a minute. I'm gonna come out of the PowerPoint so that you can see the flute for a little bit, but let me just go through this slide first. The sound is produced by blowing air across the embouchure hole. Now, this is really unusual for a woodwind instrument. All of the other instruments play with some sort of reed, whether it's a single reed for the clarinet and the saxophone or a double reed for the oboe and the bassoon. The flute has none of that. And in fact, the modern day flute is usually made out of metal, even though it's still part of the woodwind family. But as we'll see, that's because it was primarily made of wood during the Baroque time period. Did that. The flute is what's considered an open cylinder, which is a little bit strange when you think about what the flute looks like. You know, it's not open on both ends, but because we blow air across the embouchure hole, that's actually considered an open part of the cylinder. Unlike, say, the clarinet, for example, where they're blowing into the mouthpiece and it's closed. So that's a closed cylinder. That makes our sound a little bit different than the other woodwind instruments. And this is just sort of a diagram of how the sound is created. If you can sort of see on the left, there's an opening. That's where the air would go into the flute. And then the sound wave kind of travels down through the body of the instrument. And then we have keys that are on the instrument. And when we press down the keys, that lengthens the wavelength of the wave and lowers the pitch of the instrument. Now, if we want to do something that's higher, things like that, we can achieve it by changing the airspeed or the direction of the air when we're playing. I'm gonna come off of the share here for just a second, because I wanna show you, I've got my flute. So there's the three different parts. So the head joint is where the embouchure hole is. And this is where we blow air directly across the instrument. And some of it goes in and creates that wavelength that I mentioned. But this is how kind of the sound is produced. Just blowing the air straight across. Kind of fun when we start students out on the flute, we actually start them on just the head joint and we can do all sorts of fun tricks. We can do little tunes. So that's kind of fun and that keeps them occupied for at least a lesson or so. And then we have the middle joint, which is where the bulk of the keys are. And you can see there's a lot of keys, more keys than I can put fingers on, but that's because some of them are operated. There's one key that presses multiple ones down on there. So that's the sort of body of the flute. And then there's the foot joint, which just has the last little bit, gives you sort of the low notes, and it also helps with some of the high notes, which we'll talk about as we get towards the end. But the most important part is this head joint. And again, you can sort of see the embouchure hole. That's the open end of that cylinder, even though there is a closed portion here, which is there's a cork inside the head joint that helps us kind of keep the head joint in tune when we put it into the rest of the instrument. And intonation will also feature heavily in the development of the flute, since, as you will find out, early flutes were not really that much in tune. There are some that might argue that it's still not all that much in tune these days, but it is a lot better than it used to be. So, all right, I'm going to go back to presentation here. So that's where we were. All right. And then we have several members of the flute family. The one that I've shown you is sort of the basic, what we call the C flute. The piccolo is a much smaller instrument. It's the more annoying of the flute family. I've got a picture here. There's also a treble flute, which isn't used that much. So if you're looking at the picture that's on the left of this, on the right of the screen, excuse me, the piccolo is the small one. The treble flute is the next one over to the right. And then the normal kind of C flute, there's two of them in the middle. And if you look at the very bottom, the only real difference is the number of keys on the foot joint. So my foot joint on my flute is more similar to the one further to the right with three keys on it. But a lot of the student model flutes and earlier ones only have two. And again, I'll talk a little bit about why that is when we get later into the presentation. One more over to the right is the alto flute, which plays a little bit lower. And then the farthest right is the bass flute. Those are sort of the basic instruments. There are a couple more. And when we talk about repertoire, I'll show you the octavo contrabass flute, which is one that's pretty huge and it stands on the floor and you can't really hear it unless it's mic'd. So it isn't that practical to be used. So that's why these flutes are sort of the primary ones if you're gonna see flute in an ensemble, that we will do that. So this is sort of the basic step. Does anybody have any questions about anything about the basic of the flute before we get into the history?
If you have questions for Professor Southard, you can share them in the chat window or feel free to come off mute and ask him yourself. Don't see any in the chat right now, but again, if you'd be willing to come off mute and share a question for him, otherwise we're ready to keep going. I think you're good to move forward.
All right, cool. Well, let's get into the history then of the flute. The flute is one of the oldest instruments. Voice, of course, is the oldest. And then percussion probably would have been the second one, you know, strike rocks together and stuff like that. But the flute would have been the next oldest. The first known flute, what we actually found recently, was found in Germany around 40,000 BC. And this is a bone flute. And you can sort of see from the picture on here, it has the same basic components. You would blow across the top of it. And then there's just a couple holes that were drilled into the flute itself. So that's really one of the first ones that have been found. And it's kind of interesting that they were actually that kind of old. Other ones were made from bird bones. And you can sort of see this is a picture of a vulture, and they would have taken the wing bones from the vulture and put holes into it. And since the bone is very light, it actually made it very easy to kind of puncture the holes into it and also to play. So that was another way that they would do it. And this picture I just thought was amusing. I don't know. I'm sure that is not what the early cavemen looked like when they were playing the flute. But anyways, it gives you an idea of how that might work. If my wife were watching this, she'd be appalled that I shared that with you. But anyways, that's neither here nor there. So we do have several types of flutes came about past this point. Another one of the fairly old ones was the pan flute. And we know that the Greeks used this instrument. And essentially, it's a series of end-blown pipes. So they would be made out of reeds or bamboo or something like that of different lengths that are all tied together. And they're named that way because for Pan, who was one of the Greek gods. And the story behind the pan flute is, oh, I've got a picture of it here too. There's the pan flute. Is that Pan fell in love with a water nymph and was pursuing her and trying to get her to fall in love with him. And essentially, she wanted nothing to do with him. So she kind of prayed to the gods and said, hey, get me away from this Pan guy. So Athena took pity on her and actually turned her into reeds on the bank of the river that she was from. And then when Pan couldn't find her, he was distraught and decided that the way to get past his sadness was to cut the reeds that had newly appeared on the side of the river and create a pan flute without really knowing that he was actually cutting the person that he had been pursuing. So, yeah, typical happy Greek myth as we go along. But some of the ones that they have found are about 35,000 years old. And as I mentioned, we know that the ancient Greeks used them to perform on. And the instrument actually has endured, and there are a number of folks that still play on the pan flute today. In fact, I'm going to show you, if you've ever seen somebody play the pan flute, you've probably seen this person, Zamfir. He was touted as the master of the pan flute, and he actually wrote a number of tunes for the instrument. And I just want to show you a little bit. In order to get the different pitches on the pan flute, you have to move between the different lengths of pipe. So you actually have to be fairly agile to make this instrument work and sound like anything, basically. So here's a little bit of Zamfir. He's playing a tune that he wrote for a movie called Kill Bill. And you may have heard this. Sorry, Bill, nothing in the, but here's a little bit of Zamfir playing. That gives you a little bit of pan flute. I'm always amazed at how clear and how agile he is on the pan flute. I think it's really kind of a neat instrument. The couple times I've tried playing on it have not nearly sounded that good, so it's kind of been put back into my closet a little bit. So that's pan flute. Again, sort of an earlier instrument for the ancient Greeks. Oh, Then we also have some early Japanese and Chinese instruments that we found kind of early on. The shakuhachi is a Japanese instrument. That's the oldest one we found is about 10,000 years old. And that particular flute, you actually kind of blow across the top and it's held vertically instead of like the transverse flute that we hold off to the side. This one would have five holes for a pentatonic scale or a five note scale, which was very traditional for actually both the Japanese and Chinese musicians to build their music off of a little bit of a different sound. And that is a picture of the shakuhachi. And you can see these, they've got the four holes on the front, and then there's also one on the back for the thumb. So that would have been the fifth hole. And then the very top, which is on the furthest right, you can see that's where you would blow across. And it's the same type. It's not like the recorder where you would blow into it, but it's like the modern flute where you would actually blow air across and create the sound that way. And I'll do a little bit more of the shakuhachi in just a minute. There's also the zhao, which is a bamboo flute in China. And that one is about 1,000 years old. And that one has a few more, so that has a little bit more of a flexibility as far as what notes you could play on the instrument. And the picture here on the right is several types of the zhao, the bamboo flutes. And yeah, these were all made of bamboo and were very typical for the Chinese to play early on, so about 1,000 years old. They still play them now. In fact, the shakuhachi is still in use now as well, and they haven't changed very much from the time that they were created. They still play on the more traditional instruments. Now, the shakuhachi is a particularly interesting instrument. See, back in the days, they would play with what was called sort of a traditional basket. And they think one of the reasons that this happened is they would actually send shakuhachi into enemy camps as spies. So they would come in and they'd be playing music and they'd have the basket on so that you couldn't tell who they were. And they were very effective as spies that way. And if they happened to get caught, the very bottom of the instrument you can see is a little bit thicker than sort of the rest of it. It was a bamboo knot. And then they could actually use that as a weapon. So I thought that was kind of an interesting thing. You don't typically think of the flute as a weapon. Although there was a James Bond movie fairly recently, I don't know if you saw, where there was a bass flute that the assassin turned into a gun. So maybe there is some something about turning a flute into an instrument. A flute into a weapon, which holds some water perhaps. But anyways, we tend not to use them as weapons now, which is good. And but the shakuhachi is, there's a lot of music that is for modern flute that is actually based off of the sound of the shakuhachi. And I wanted to play a little bit of, this is one of the grand masters, he's actually playing at a church service in this particular video. And you can sort of hear the traditional sound, which has some slides and some pitch bending in it. And just the sort of the bamboo sound that you would get from a shakuhachi. So here's a little bit of this. There's a little intro here. So you can see this is a pretty early piece.
Thank you.
very beautiful instrument. Like I said, there have been a number of pieces that have been written for the modern day flute that are meant to imitate the shakuhachi. But really, I mean, there's no imitating the sound that you can get from an original. And certainly, Riley Lee is one of the best shakuhachi players in the world. So that takes us into... theoretically. Okay. So now we get to, now we've talked about some of the ancient instruments, and there are more. I've deliberately left some out, but those were certainly the most important, kind of leading towards the modern flute. Now, in the 14th century, so you notice that the shakuhachi was played in a vertical fashion. And indeed, there were a lot of flutes that were played that way. And the recorder, the recorder also plays in vertical. In the 14th century, people started to switch to transverse flutes, which basically means just playing across to the side, which is what our modern day flute is. And this was, it was for a couple reasons. It made it a little bit easier to produce the airstream necessary. It actually made the intonation a little bit better. And it projected the tone in a slightly different way. We're coming out instead of straight down. So that was something that happened. Flute still was not particularly useful for ensemble work and things like that. Originally, flutes were made of wood, and they had no keys. So the very early flutes were just, they had holes, just like the shakuhachi and the zao that you saw, where you would play and you would have to cover the keys, cover the holes to get the different pitches. In 1660, the first key was added and allowed the flute to play D sharp, which was something that was impossible on early flutes. There wasn't a lot of chromatic usage for the flutes at all. So you couldn't do a lot of the music that we could do on our flute today back in the Baroque time period. And we'll see. Well, here's there's a picture off to the right here. That's a picture of one of the very early flutes with that one key you can sort of see at the very bottom of the instrument. And everything else is the holes that you would have to cover. Now, as we get past sort of into the Baroque time period, which was when Bach was writing, we consider the Baroque time period from 1600 to 1750, conveniently ending in 1750, which was the year that Johann Sebastian Bach died. This is where we start seeing some developments of the flute to allow it to be played in ensembles more regularly, and also to help with the intonation and playing different keys. Now, originally, the flute was only useful for a few different types of keys that were around it, like up to two or three sharps. And then anything around that, it was so out of tune, it just couldn't play in the other keys. In some ways, this is like, I've got this a little bit later, but it's sort of like the harpsichord. Where if you know anything about just temperament and equal temperament, back in the Baroque time period, scales were made for specific keys. So like the harpsichord, for instance, would play in one key, and it could play a couple keys nearby, but then it would be out of tune for the other one, other keys. So you would have to retune it, or you would have to change the stops on it. And then later on, the piano was invented, which was equal temperament, which means that every note was specifically a half step apart, and you could play in all of the keys. But if you were to play the piano for somebody from the Baroque time period, they would have said that all of those keys sound out of tune. So we gave up this sort of just temperament for something that was more flexible in keys. But the Baroque flute was sort of the same way. It was really only useful for a few keys. There were some that were different size, but basically it was not very useful for playing in a lot of different keys. It was also very unstable tonally. So it would play out of tune, even to the just temperament of the time. And it was just not a very loud instrument. So a lot of times composers would just ignore the flute and wouldn't write for them. I do have a recording here. This is another Baroque flute with a few more keys that had been added. Now this recording is of a Bach sonata. So it's originally written for Baroque flute and harpsichord. And this is actually being played on the Baroque flute. So you can kind of get an idea for what it sounded like versus what we know about the modern flute sound. So here's a little bit of this. That's the first movement of a Bach sonata in E minor. Now you may be saying, you know, from listening to that, it's like, well, that sounds like a pretty loud instrument. Bear in mind that the harpsichord was also a fairly soft instrument. So it's sort of in perspective, not a very, very loud instrument when you get there. So the Baroque flute then was being played, as I said, during the Baroque time period. Quantz, who was probably one of the best known flute virtuosos of the time, started to notice a lot of the hangbacks of the flute and started working towards making it a much more useful instrument, both for solo and for ensemble work. He was a flute teacher and a court musician for Frederick the Great of Prussia, although he did move around and did a lot of performances in other areas of the world as well. Now, under his supervision, this is where we start seeing some of the first major changes to the Baroque flute. What's interesting is Quantz wasn't a mechanic. He didn't actually do the work himself, but he said, hey, here's something that I want that to happen. And then he would go to the flute makers and they would actually make the change under his instruction. So he didn't do the actual work himself, but sort of passed it on to the folks that would do it. And part of this was when he was traveling in Italy, Quantz met Antonio Scarlatti. And Scarlatti told him very bluntly, he said, you know what, I tend not to use the flute or any wind instruments because they're just out of tune. I don't like using them, they're impractical. And Quantz, you know, said, well, boy, this isn't good. I want the flute to be used. So he started to think about improving it. And actually, even before that, Quantz was such a virtuoso, he played for Scarlatti. And Scarlatti, you know, after hearing him, said, you know what, maybe I can start using the flute. And he started using it in a limited fashion in his music, based on his meeting with Quantz. But still, there was this stigma against using the flute because it was out of tune, soft, and all those things. So some of the things that Quantz helped make, I already mentioned that he added the separate E flat key, and then he added that there was already a D sharp key that was on there. Now, this is again coming back to just temperament and equal temperament. If you know things about music, you know that in parlance, E flat and D sharp are actually inharmonic notes, which means they're basically the same note. If you were to look on a piano keyboard, if you were going to play E flat on there, it's the same thing as D sharp, just in a different key. But in the Baroque time period, with this just temperament, E flat and D sharp were actually different notes. They were in different pitches. So this allowed an improved intonation for those two specific notes with the just temperament. And it was a small improvement, but it was an improvement nonetheless. And actually Quantz played on this instrument with the separate E flat and D sharp keys for most of his life, something he particularly liked. Unfortunately, outside of Prussia and Germany, it didn't pick up a lot of steam in other parts of the world. Now, inspired by Quantz, in London at about the same time, they started adding additional keys. So not, you know, this is not something that Quantz did, but perhaps because he started adding the E-flat key to it, they said, hey, well, let's do this. Let's improve the intonation of the instrument. Quantz also experimented with other materials other than the bamboo that would make hopefully the flute project a little bit better. And he tried things like ebony, boxwood, grenadilla, glass, and even created some flutes out of amber. Now, I was not able to find any pictures of an amber flute, so I don't think that one was particularly successful. But boxwood flutes actually were what he sort of ended up using for most of his flutes that were created. And then glass actually was fairly popular. And today we have glass and crystal flutes. They aren't used all that much, but they're sort of historical curiosity that folks will play. So you can see on the screen, that's a picture of the glass flute that might have been played during Quantz's time. I think one of the reasons that people don't play them very much, again, there's condensation that comes into play when you're playing the flute. And I don't think people particularly like seeing things kind of dribbling down the inside of the flute because it was made out of glass. Sorry, that's sad. But at least the closed metal flutes hide some of the messier parts of flute playing, shall we say. So, but the glass flute was something that people had been experimenting with. But the boxwood was sort of what he ended up with. The next really important person in the flute world was Theobald Baim. And in fact, our modern flute is based off of the Baim method. So all of our flutes that we play on are Baim model flutes. And they started out with the same sort of ideas that Quantz had. But he was able to do improvements on the flute himself. He was a flute virtuoso. He did a lot of performing, but he was also a craftsman and a metal worker. So he was able to do a lot of the experimenting and changing of the flute himself.
Unlike Quantz, who had to go and actually had other people do it, he was able to do a lot of things on his own. So he started adding on these multiple keys. As I mentioned, the folks in London, he had a four key flute and started adding more and more. And eventually he ended up sort of with the eight key flute. And that is basically where we are. And like I said, it influenced his research. Now we call this the BAME flute. Another important thing that he changed, the flute in Quantz's time and earlier was what we consider a conical instrument, which basically means that where you start playing, the embouchure hole is one bore width, and then it would start to get larger, albeit almost imperceptibly, towards the end of the instrument. Now that had a lot of influence on how the instrument sounded. It was one of the reasons it was not as loud as it could have been. It's also one of the reasons that it was fairly out of tune. So one of the things that BAME did was take the flute and make the bore size the same all the way through and turned it into a cylindrical instrument, which gave him a lot more control over placing the keys on the instrument and controlling the intonation. He also added, and I'll show you some of these. Let me stop the share for just a second. So on the flute itself, so you can see, I mean, this is a conical. You can see it's basically the same bore size all the way across. It doesn't extend like the older flutes. But along with the keys, he also developed this series of rods. And you can't really see them very well, but on the underside of the keys, there are pads that allow it's a little bit easier to seal the keys, which, you know, if you were doing open holes, it was kind of hit or miss whether your finger covered the entire hole. And it also, this series, as I mentioned, allowed you to press one key and put down two keys at the same time, which gave him a lot of control over what the intonation of the instrument was able to do. Early on, I didn't mention with the Baroque flute, when they had the open holes, the only way they could play keys and notes where, you know, on this one, you can do press it down and have another hole closed, is they would actually have to half hole some of the holes on there if they wanted to get different notes. So besides the seven pitches that they could get with the normal fingering, they would actually half cover some of the holes in order to get some of the chromatic notes. And as you can imagine, that played havoc with intonation too. You know, if you didn't have it exactly halfway over the hole, it just sounded out of tune and sounded bad. So BAME sort of added this entire system that we have on here now of the rods and the keys and the pads. And he also, you know, in order to make it work, I don't know how well you can see this. But not very well. There are some keys that in order to keep them open have springs. So he developed the spring system as well. So instead of having the keys closed all the time, the springs keep them open. Then when you press it down, when you're done, the springs pop it back up. So that was huge. That was huge for the flute. It allowed for composers to write for the flute in different keys. It allowed for them to play louder, which means composers started integrating them into the orchestra and other ensembles. You can't really understate the importance of BAME in the development of the flute. Get back to right. The downfall of adding the levers and rods and things like that is it did make the flute a lot more fragile, and it made care of the instrument a lot more iffy. The Baroque flute was essentially indestructible. You could do a lot to it and not have to worry about it because there just wasn't any mechanism. And sort of like how I think of cars today, you know, sort of the more you monkey with it, the more can go wrong. That's true with the modern flute. There is more that can go wrong with it, but the benefits far outweigh the downsides of. So that sort of brings us then to our modern flute. Oh, sorry, I totally mentioned. He also experimented with materials. And since he was a metalsmith, this is where we start moving to the metal on the flute. And he experimented with a whole different set of metals than were even available to quants. And silver was sort of what was settled on as the most malleable. It had sort of a brighter tone, which a lot of the folks didn't like that were used to the wooden flute sound. But nowadays, our modern flutes are basically made out of silver. So some things that are options on our modern flutes. So silver is still probably the most used. We have silver flutes. I play on a solid silver flute. Most flute players that I know choose to use that. It is the most versatile. It allows you equal range in both the low and the high register of the flute. And it gives you a lot of ability to kind of cut through, especially in the orchestra where you've got a whole sea of strings that are up in front of you. The silver flute will allow you to kind of direct and play a little bit more through that. You can also get flutes made out of gold and platinum. And nowadays, there's actually a return to wood, not the Baroque flute, but the modern flute. So there's actually a metal core, but then wood on the outside. In fact, some of the players in the Grand Rapids Symphony Orchestra have moved to playing on kind of wood flutes, or at the very least, a wooden head joint. The benefits to playing to other materials: a gold flute has a much warmer sound. It's usually a little bit darker than the silver. Unfortunately, I find that it's less easy to project the sound through the gold. Platinum does have good projection, but if you've ever picked up a platinum flute, they're super heavy. One of my teachers, actually, when I was taking lessons in Boston years ago, had a platinum flute, and it played beautifully, and he enjoyed it, but he had to stop playing on it because it was so heavy, it was actually giving him wrist problems. So the platinum flute sounds nice, but it is not very practical from that standpoint. Plus, it's almost double the price of a silver flute. You can get a good silver flute in the $10,000 to $12,000 range. Gold flutes are more in the $20,000. Platinum now, I haven't priced them recently, but it was probably in the $35,000 to $40,000 range. So you can probably see not very many people would get platinum flutes. Some of the other things that are added to our modern flute that allow us to play 20th century techniques. There's a low B key, a C sharp trill key, and this thing, it's actually called the gizmo, which is kind of a funny thing. And let me take you off and I will show you some of these keys as well. I put my flute back together first. So, on this particular flute, see on the foot joint, it has three keys. Earlier flutes and student model flutes actually have just the two, but this allows me to play one additional note on the bottom, which is used in some traditional 20th century pieces. So normally the lowest note would be a low C. And the low B just allows me to go, which is nice. There's a couple things that you can do in music that call for low B. And if you don't have the low B key, you have to play it up the octave. C sharp trill key, I had mentioned, is this little guy right up here. And it's very aptly named because basically what it allows me to do is play a trill from B to C sharp, where normally I would have had to do both fingers, which is a lot harder to do. It's basically convenience. It also helps with the fingerings up in that extreme range up on the top. And then the gizmo is on the foot joint, and it's this little key right here. And as you can see, all it really does is push down the very farthest key on the foot joint. And what this does is allows the upper register notes, some of them, to pop a lot easier. I hope this isn't going to be ridiculously loud, but I'll use the gizmo for some of the most extreme high range notes. Without that, those notes are much harder to achieve. But the gizmo helps with that. I don't know why they call it the gizmo. I've asked flute makers, and it's just sort of one of those things like, yeah, no, it's the gizmo key. Oh, okay, sure, why not? So it's kind of a weird little thing. There are some other things that the modern flute has that the Baroque flute didn't. Certainly the ability to adjust the cork in the head joint, as I mentioned, that helps with intonation quite a bit. And the key action is much faster on a modern flute than it was on Baroque flute, which helps us go faster. It makes our technique a lot easier, which in some cases is good. But it's also mean that composers that write for the flute typically like for us to play really fast all the time. And the flute is a beautiful instrument when it plays slow and low. Yeah, what can you do? All right, and then just a couple other little things that are different when you do a student model flute. So I mentioned that the modern day flute is pretty fragile. If you give a fragile instrument to a sixth grader, that's generally a recipe for disaster. So flute makers have made what we call student model flutes, which are much more durable. They're made of nickel. Sometimes they'll be silver plated, but that's something that is much less likely to scratch or dent. And the mechanisms are much more protected. They also have closed holes, which my flute, I don't know if you noticed when I was showing you, has open holes on it, which open the sound up, but also makes those keys a little bit more bendable. Closed holes are much more durable for students that are playing that. So that's, you know, sort of brings up to the modern flute. I wanted to play you a more contemporary piece. This is a piece called Illusions. I believe I've chosen the second movement for you to listen to by Dana Wilson, who is a contemporary composer. And this particular tune is being played by one of my former teachers, Wendy Maney, who is the flute teacher at Ithaca College. And this just gives you an idea, if you think back to the sound of the Baroque flute and you know, how it sounded and sort of now the modern flexibility of the modern flute. So here's a little bit of Illusions by Dana Wilson. Thank you. obviously a lot more flexible than what you'd be able to do on the Baroque flute. So, and there's some 20th century techniques in there that, as we get into the repertoire in future classes, we'll certainly talk about what the flute is capable of. We'll get into that. I just want to show you the list of stuff. This is all the pieces that were in this presentation. If you're interested in checking them out or listening to anything further, you can certainly do that. I guess, what questions do you guys have?
Yeah, thank you, Professor. At this time, if anyone has any questions, you can enter them into the chat window at the bottom of your screen using the chat icon. You can type those in, or you can use the raised hand feature if you're comfortable with that, or simply unmute yourself. We'll be able to notice that and we can invite you to ask a question. Professor, I have one to get us started here. You mentioned the cost of the standard silver flute, and then you went above some of those. What's the cost for the student model flute that you talked about?
That's a good question. Student model flutes, you can get good ones anywhere from $800 to $1,000, $1,200, something like that. But if you are looking for a good student model flute, or if you have somebody that's starting the instrument, a lot of music stores will actually do a rental program where you can pay 25 or 30 bucks a month. But the student model flute is much more affordable than the pro models.
Great. Another question regarding what you might find in an orchestra. You listed a number of different variations of the flute from the piccolo all the way up to that bass flute. What's the most common to find in an orchestra, and would you find those less common ones in a piece for a specific piece?
Definitely. So the flute that I play on, the Neural C flute, is sort of the standard. And you would usually have two or three of those for a piece in an orchestra. The piccolo is also very common. You see that quite a bit. Oftentimes the second or the third chair player in the orchestra will double on piccolo. So they'll do both of those. It is pretty unusual to see alto flute or bass flute in an orchestra, just from the simple fact that they're a lot harder to hear. They're a lot softer than the C flute. But there are some pieces, Holst's The Planets, for instance, calls for both alto flute and bass flute. And he scores very carefully for that. It's usually, I'm trying to remember the movement that it's in. But it's scored in a way that there's really not much else going on, so that the voices of those instruments can really be heard. Most of the time, you're going to see alto flute and bass flute in a flute choir setting, where it's all just flutes playing anyways. So.
Thank you. Sure. I'll ask again if anyone has any questions, they can come off mute and share those. One more, Professor, from just observing. You mentioned the different parts of the flute, and you had it put in pieces and you put it together. Are those parts replaceable the same way you would place tires on a car, or would you purchase a whole new flute if you had and the need to?
Yeah. The only part that really is replaceable in that type of fashion is the head joint, the part where you actually blow into. In fact, when you go and buy flutes, a lot of times you buy sort of the body of the flute, and then you try out a number of head joints to see which one works best with your own personal lip shape, your own lung capacity, and things like that. So when I tried flutes a number of years ago, I actually went into Flute World in Michigan. It's a great place, a place called Flute World, you can't go wrong with. But I tried several bodies of flutes. And then on top of that, I probably had another 20 head joints that I played on. And I play on a pearl flute for a couple of reasons. One, it was actually one of the better ones that I tried. And also, I'm a pearl flute artist. So the Pearl Flute Company actually approached me after they heard me play at a National Flute Association convention. And they said, hey, we want you to be part of our team. So right now I play on a pearl flute, and it's easily one of the best flutes I've ever played on. So nice.
Thank you. It looks like Bill has a question here. Could you please go over the difference between just temperament and equal temperament?
Yes. Yeah. So I think equal temperament is actually the easier one to start with. So if you think about the modern day piano, the modern day piano can play in any key and any chromatic idea. And that's because, without going into too much music theory, the distance between each note is exactly the same. So, if I were
playing on,
distance between each one of those notes is exactly the same. But when you are playing in an ensemble or a chord or something like that, the difference in between those notes is actually not the same. So back in the Baroque time period, they were actually more sensitive to this than we are today. So there would be a difference depending on what piece you were playing and what key you were playing. They wouldn't necessarily be a half step between every single note. There might be some that were a little bit smaller in pitch, some a little bit larger, to make it work for that particular key that they were in. And the harpsichord was set up this way, which is one of the reasons that you could only do certain keys with the harpsichord set up the way it was, and then you have to change all of the strings and the keys on the inside. But it was more in tune to even our ears, because if you listen to an orchestra play a chord, they are automatically making those adjustments towards the just temperament side of things. They're not playing equal temperament within the ensemble. But unfortunately, what that meant for the harpsichord is it wasn't very flexible. It wasn't able to play in multiple keys, and it was kind of a pain in the neck to make a switch to go to something different. So you would be able to play in three or four related keys, and then you would have to make a switch. And that's why the piano came into being. So with every note exactly the same distance apart, they could play in any key, and mentioned equally out of tune in every key. So, but our modern ears hear the piano as being in tune because that's sort of what we've been grown up with. Does that make it clearer, Bill?
Gabe, sounds like Bill's good there, and we'll go over to Sarah Briggs, who has a question.
Gabe, could you talk a bit about breath control, how you learned to do that? I mean, that's a really, and that last piece that you played, that was very demanding, I think. And do flute players do circular breathing sometimes?
We do. it's not something that we typically do an awful lot of. It's very hard for exactly the reason that you mentioned, because you have to use so much air on the flute to make the sound. We waste an awful lot of air. When you blow across the embouchure hole, there's probably about 30 or 40% that actually goes into the flute. And then the rest of it just goes off into the ether. we have to use a lot of air. And speaking to the first part of your question, the way we kind of learn that is we have to learn to kind of expand our lungs and our lung capacity. We do that by practicing long tones, just trying to hold notes for longer, and also various breathing exercises. And that piece Illusions, definitely there are parts in there that are very hard to find places to breathe. Bach, of course, anytime playing Bach on a modern flute, it's really hard to find stuff to breathe because the Baroque flute didn't use nearly as much air. So normally when I play a Bach piece, I'm kind of gasping for breath in between phrases. But we spend a lot of time training on that. It's also one of the reasons that it's hard to do circular breathing on the flute, because in order to circular breathe, you have to keep a certain airstream steady coming from your mouth. And you also are simultaneously breathing in with your nose. And there are some flute players that can do that. Personally, I haven't spent the time to do it. If I get a few months at some point, maybe I'll take the time to do it. But it's very challenging on flute to circular breathe. Other instruments that are more closed and use less air, it's a lot easier for them to do it.
Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. Professor, I believe you mentioned that the flute is considered a woodwind instrument. With my knowledge, a lot of woodwind instruments and a lot of woodwind players can fluctuate between different instruments within the woodwind family. Is the flute considered to be part of that expertise and repertoire, or is it kind of an exception to that?
No, it definitely is. And one of the things that is kind of neat about the woodwind family is when you are playing, the flute, the fingerings are basically the same as the clarinet and the saxophone and the oboe. There are some instruments that play in a different key. For instance, the clarinet is what we would call a B-flat instrument, which means if I were to play a C on the flute and I were to finger that, if I were to finger the same C on the clarinet, it actually sounds like a B-flat coming out of it, just because of the different length of the instrument. But that's one of the trade-offs. In order to keep the fingerings the same, the notes end up coming out differently. The saxophone is another one. The alto saxophone is an E-flat instrument. So if I finger the same C on that, an E-flat comes out of it. But yes, the flute, you could definitely, and that's why doubling in the woodwind instruments is particularly effective. As long as you can learn the different embouchures, and flute is very different in that regard. All of the others you play into a reed or into a double reed, but the flute, as I mentioned, you blow the air across the hole. But as long as you can learn to do that, you can basically double on any of the woodwind instruments.
Thank you. Well, Bill, at this time, we don't have any additional questions, but I am looking forward to next week's session. When the professor mentioned that we're going to see what the flute is capable of, my eyes got a little big, so I'm excited to see what that is, especially as a fan of 70s rock music and of current pop music. I think it's going to be exciting to find out what we can do. But Bill, if you'd like to unmute yourself and close our session today, we very much appreciate it.
There, I should be unmuted now.
Yeah, we got you now, Bill.
Gabe, thank you very much for your presentation. It was easy to follow. You used the Zoom to good effect, but mostly it was your knowledge and your personality that projected and made this a very successful, I think, hour and 15 or 20 minutes. And I, for one, and I'm sure others, are looking forward to next week as well. Thanks.
Well, thank you. It was my pleasure. I enjoyed doing it. So.
Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next week at the same time, 9:30, next Wednesday morning, and see us back on Zoom again. Take care, everyone. Thank you, Professor. We'll see you next week.
Sounds good. Thank you. Have a good one.
You too. Take care.